reception wherever he goes and wherever we go. So for our last speaker tonight, would you please welcome the chair of the Yes Scotland Advisory Board, and I know a friend of us all here tonight, Mr. Dennis Canavan.
Thank you, Blair, for your kind words of introduction. I'd like to begin tonight with a wee story about a personal journey, or rather, various personal journeys. This venue is just along the road from Glasgow Central Station. Way back in the 1970s, quite often on a Friday morning, I would get off the London sleeper very early in the morning, and I always found that the term British Rail sleeper for me was a misnomer, because I could be sleep on them. And I used to feel like, oh dear, I think I'll just walk along to Queen Street, get another train and get home to my bed. However, there was often missionary work to be done, not just in my own constituency, but I would regularly receive invitations from the students in Glasgow University Labour Club to go along and speak to them. And Glasgow University Labour Club at that time considered themselves to be a very radical outfit, very anti-establishment. In fact, a very left-wing. In fact, they were so anti-establishment and so radical and so left-wing that they wouldn't even participate in the debates with the other students. This was apparently a reaction to a previous era of Labour politicians who had graduated from Glasgow University in the 50s and 60s, including the late John Smith and Donald Dewar. And because Donald Dewar and John Smith used to get dressed up in a suit and a bow tie and take part in the debates. And they usually won the debates, by the way. They won great competitions in these days. But the students of the 60s and 70s reacted against this and said they wanted nothing to do with these establishment debates. And the Prime Minister at the time was Harold Wilson. Harold Wilson was described by many of them as a class traitor who had sold the working class down the river, and the students too, because the poor students weren't getting grants and were kept up with inflation, despite the fact that inflation was running about 25%. And the student grant, the average student grant at that time was the much below the average manual workers' wage. So, anyway, to be fair, they gave me a hard time because they thought that I was part of the establishment too. You know, I was a young Labour MP at the time. But to be fair, they didn't just campaign for themselves. They campaigned to save the welfare state. They campaigned to save jobs in industries such as coal and steel and shipbuilding. They campaigned against nuclear weapons, and as I said, they campaigned against the establishment of the day. Now, fast forward, I see some of the erstwhile student revolutionaries have joined the establishment, and some of them indeed have become parliamentary representatives for this great city of Glasgow. I see one Joanne Lamont, who is leader of the Scottish Labour Party. I see Margaret Kern, who is Shadow Secretary of State for Scotland. I see Ian Davidson, who chairs the Scottish Affairs Select Committee in the House of Commons. Ian was a student at Jordan Hill way back in the 1970s. When I look at them, I wish to heck I never thought I would live to see the day when these erstwhile student revolutionaries would become so much part of the establishment that they would wrap themselves in the Union Jack, climb into bed with the Tories, and try to defend the traditional role of the Labour Party. The reason why the Labour Party was founded was to try to defend the working class. Now we have Labour politicians going around spending more time and energy defending an indefensible union instead of defending the working class. So yes, they've come a long way. I suppose they might say the same about me, except that my personal path had a different destination. I'm a convert, a self-confessed convert to the cause of independence, and my conversion is not based on emotion. It's based on my experience, mainly my parliamentary experience of 26 years at Westminster, 8 years in the Scottish Parliament, and I've been retired now for over 5 years, and I've had time to reflect, time to think about some of the things that happened during these years of my parliamentary service, and some of the big events that took place in Scotland and the rest of the world. And I have come to the conclusion that Westminster is completely out of touch with the people of Scotland. The Scottish Parliament, on the other hand, it's not perfect. I mean, it's a human organisation, it consists of human beings, and it sometimes makes mistakes. But I think that the Scottish Parliament has shown that it can respond far more positively and far more readily to the needs and the aspirations of the people of Scotland on things like, I think that Nicola mentioned some of them before, on things like land reform. I think that the Land Reform Scotland Act of 2003 was one of the most radical pieces of legislation passed by the Scottish Parliament, and Westminster never ever had the time to pass that kind of legislation. I can think of the abolition of the tuition fees which had been introduced by Westminster. I can think of the restoration of free prescriptions and of course free care for the elderly. And I sincerely believe that if the Scottish Parliament had the full powers of an independent parliament in an independent Scotland, then it would be able to do so much more. I also believe that independence is absolutely essential now for the defence of the welfare state against Westminster politicians who are increasingly out of touch with the needs of the people of Scotland. Last week, for example, we had the spectacle of MPs voting to decrease in real terms the benefits for some of the poorest people in society. And yet at the same time, many of those same MPs were clamouring for a 32% increase in their own salaries. If that ever sees the light of day, we mean that they were pocketing £90,000 per year, while at the same time voting to cut the benefits of the poor. I mean, that is obscene in anybody's language, and I couldn't see any Scottish Parliament or any Scottish government in an independent Scotland putting up with that. And very sadly, the opposition at Westminster offers no real alternative, and leading Labour politicians even question the universal benefits which have been introduced by the Scottish Parliament, such as the restoration of free prescriptions, the abolition of tuition fees, and the provision of free care for the elderly. A something for nothing society, they shriek, giving out sweeties to the people of Scotland to try and get their votes. What an insult! I mean, is free education a sweetie? Is a free National Health Service a sweetie? I mean, Nye Bevan and Barbara Castle must be burning in their graves. Nye Bevan saw a free National Health Service as a hallmark of a fair society. And it was Barbara Castle who, back in the 1970s, defended universal benefits. All this argument and debate that's going on just now about whether universal benefits is the best way to distribute wealth. There's nothing new in this argument. There's no need for these people to have a review. Barbara Castle answered them way back in the 1970s when she was asked, why should the children of the rich people get child benefit? And she said that if a universal child benefit is combined with a progressive system of taxation whereby the rich pay more in tax and the poor pay less or none at all, then that will bring about the redistribution of wealth which fair people want to see. And if the current generation of Westminster politicians are unwilling to do that, then in all honesty, they should hand over all the responsibility for benefits and all the responsibility for taxation within Scotland to the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government. Because I'm sure that in an independent Scotland, a Scottish Government and a Scottish Parliament will respond far more readily, far more positively to the needs of the people of Scotland, including the need for greater standards of social justice. So I don't see independence as an end in itself. I see it as a means towards bringing about changes in Scotland, including higher standards of social justice. And it's not just the achievement of a fairer Scotland that independence could bring, it is also the achievement of a safer, more secure Scotland. Reference has been made by other speakers about us being dragged in the fairly recent past into illegal wars, and the reference has been made to the existence of the biggest nuclear arsenal in Western Europe, just about half an hour's drive from where you're sitting. An independent Scottish Parliament would be able to take decisions on whether or not we are engaged in war, and an independent Scottish Parliament would also be able to take decisions to rid Scotland of nuclear weapons, help to bring about a nuclear-free Scotland, a contribution to a nuclear-free Britain, a nuclear-free Europe, and a nuclear-free world. So, as I say, I feel that independence would help to bring about a fairer Scotland, a more secure Scotland. I also think it would help to bring about a more secure world. I mean, I must confess that I am not a nationalist. I mean, I appreciate that many of you are, and I respect you for that, but I prefer the description internationalist and I want to see an independent Scotland playing a full role in the international community. So it's not a case of Scotland becoming some kind of little backwater remote from the rest of the world. I want to see us continuing to have close relationships with our nearest neighbours on as equal partners in that relationship. I also want to see us having good working relationships with the rest of Europe and the rest of the world and playing a full part in the international community in order to try to bring about a better and a fairer world. So just to finish, I want to comment on a question which I think must be going through some of your minds anyway. What are our chances of success in this campaign? Well, if we are to believe most of the recent opinion polls, it would appear that at this stage, only a minority of people in Scotland are supporting us in this campaign. But you know, I think that even the recent opinion polls give some grounds for optimism, because if we look at the trend over the past 6 months or so, there's a significant number of people who are moving from the firm no camp into the undecided camp. And it's these people that we must target. I mean, there are hundreds of thousands of people out there who have yet to make up their minds. And we, in this campaign, have got to get out there and win the hearts and minds of these people. We have the potential to be the biggest community-based campaign that Scotland has ever seen. And we must aim to get out there and campaign throughout Scotland, in every city, every town, every village, every street, every home, every workplace. Get that positive message across that it's only in an independent Scotland that we will get the government that we vote for. And it's only through independence that the people of Scotland will be able to shape their own future. That is the positive message we must get across to the people of Scotland. And if we get that message across, we shall win a historic victory. So let's go for it.
Thank you very much, Dennis, for that very inspiring address tonight, and thank you indeed to all of tonight's speakers. To pick up on Dennis's last theme there, I've been saying since I started in this job, what we need to do to win is, if every person who's already decided to vote yes can persuade just one other person, one undecided person, by the time you get to the day of the referendum, then we win. So your job is, among other things, persuade just one other person, and we'll be over that finishing line in October 2014. A couple of things, bits of information I'd like to share with you or pass on to you before we wind things up tonight. Those participation sheets, please, when you leave tonight, hand them over to some of the Yes volunteers, whom you'll see in Yes t-shirts outside the hall. You can also, you'll see there are stalls representing each of the wards in Glasgow, and go to those stalls and talk to the people in those local areas about campaigns in those areas. There are stalls for groups within the broader Yes campaign: Yes Youth and Students, Women for Independence, Labour for Independence, Trade Unionists for Independence, and there's a Radical Independence stall. There's Yes merchandise out there you can buy as well. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there's been a fantastic energy in this hall tonight. It's been terrific to be here and to be part of it. We need to take that away tonight and build on it. I do firmly believe that Yes Scotland is going to win. and I do believe that we're going to win in Glasgow. With your help, we will definitely win in Glasgow. This, as other speakers have said, is a broadly based campaign, a very broadly based campaign. The movement for independence is not to be understood in terms of the difference between right and left, but the difference between right and wrong. And that's the difference on which this campaign is based. All of us involved in Yes Scotland feel an enormous sense of pride and privilege at being part of this campaign. I have always liked the saying that the best way to predict the future is to create the future. Please, all of you tonight, go away tonight and help us to create that future, an independent Scotland. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Mention the ward you live in. Yeah? Take it to that ward. Thank you very much indeed. Thanks.